still the original, still the best, now for more than 12 years. This is Radio Free Cybertron, hosted by Brian Kilby, with J.D. Church, John DeLuna, XV, Amy Morgan, Peter Van, and Rob Clay. For the latest Transformers news, visit tformers.com.
This is Radio Free Cybertron for the day after Christmas, December 26th, 2012. I am Brian Kilby. With me I have Rob Clay and John DeLuna. Gentlemen. Gentlemen, start your podcast. That was the saddest thing I've ever said. So this is our after Christmas show. We had our big year end show last week. So this week we is that E Honda?
Yes.
It's what's Chibi E Honda or something?
Yeah, this is like the kid robot E Honda. So it's like the hippie douchebag Chibi version of him.
Nice. Yeah.
Yes.
So, we're not doing a live show this week. I guess it's technically live. But we're not doing a live show in front of a studio audience. We don't have the chat going this week. We just have a couple of news items. We have some pre-recorded goodness for you. We have a review this week of Fall of Cybertron Sounblaster from Rob in XV. And John has a Maiden Japan Junkion set review. And we also have an interview from earlier in the year with John Barber, which aired on Fanboy Versus. We actually didn't play the interview in its entirety on RSC, so we're going to do that for this show. It was really good. It was a really, really good interview. I really enjoyed it. JD and company did a great job with that. Actually, like I said, day after Christmas, 2012. You know, one of the cool things about being a super awesome podcaster is people email me all the time. It's like, Brian, I want to give you something for Christmas. And I'm always like, no, I don't want you to send me anything. Give it to Toys for Tots or give it to this. But if you do want to help me out, what you could do, leave us a review on iTunes. We haven't had a review in a while. So if you love RFC, or even if you like RFC, we are on iTunes. Go give us a review. We haven't had one in a while. We need more. That really helps people find this show.
Yeah. Subscribe. You don't have to listen. Just subscribe if you don't mind.
Yeah. Subscribing helps. It doesn't hurt. Most of our audience comes from iTunes, which surprises me because I like completely ignore iTunes, but most people still use it. So, just leave us a review. We would appreciate that. That would be awesome. So, a couple items in the news this week. Also on this week's show, it's our monthly third-party roundup. I completely blew over that. That's what we do every month. Actually, some really neat stuff this time. And I think the biggest news item of the week comes from the third-party roundup, but we really can't get into that until we get to that segment. So, I don't remember if I mentioned this or not last week. I know I mentioned it on our Facebook page, but we got photos of the Creo Predaking kit. We've already seen the other kits, but I think this is the first time we've seen, or most recent time we've seen, the Predaking kit. I like it, except for that head.
What's wrong with the head?
The face is kind of lacking. It's cute, but it doesn't really scream Predaking. I think it's the teeth. That may be part of it. I don't know. It's just not the body. God, this sounds sort of terrible. I really like its body and the way it's laid out. Uh-huh. And I think that overall, it's a great Creo interpretation. It's kind of impressionistic in a way. You know, it hits all the notes, but it's not, you know, slavishly detailed. But the head just doesn't do it.
You don't like the snarl?
No, I don't. Yeah. I don't. I really don't want to pay $40 for a third-party head, which will almost certainly come out.
Oh, yes, and wings, I'm sure.
Yeah, it is missing
proper
wings.
Yeah, more proper wings.
Yeah.
I think it's got some.
I think those shoulder things are supposed to be the wings.
Yes, I think you're right. I do appreciate the toes. Of course, that's oddly one of the more iconic or recognizable things about Predaking.
Yeah,
funky toes.
And that's the only one where the toes matter. Of course, you know, the others don't have toes, but they have feet. They pretty much have the same two panels for feet, except for Devastator. Of course, Devastator, if yours stands up straight, you're lucky.
Yeah, Devastator doesn't really count. All the other ones are standing on those, you know, I don't know what to call them, frying pans or whatever they are. They're just, you know, your basic Scramble City stuff. Same fist. I guess everybody has the same fist. Does, Did he have different fists?
Yeah, he has like points on his. Yeah.
He got special at the end.
I think they're all detailed a little differently, though.
Maybe like slightly, I think.
Well, I mean, Bruticus, his fists are hollow. I mean, so his are entirely different.
Yeah, they are. Yeah, and like Abominus, his fists are more or less solid, right? I think.
Yeah, well, the others are solid.
Yeah. Abominus. Yeah. Oh, I hope we get an Abominus at some point.
Yeah, but Predaking is one of the non-Scramble City combiners from G1, and thus holds a special place in all our hearts.
If you say so.
I still like Defensor better. Actually, Defensor has Hollow Fist, too, I think.
Mm, what a jerk.
Yeah. But it's not bad. I just don't like the head.
Is cool. I'm glad they paid homage to him. You know, perfect or not, it is kind of neat that they pulled him out of the closet.
Oh yeah, absolutely. You know, I would. I mean, I think Predaking is one of the more iconic combiners from G1. If they're going to go G1 with the combiners, I mean, I don't think they're going to do like a Magnaboss or Predacus.
Who?
Exactly.
Predaking always had the advantage of having a more cohesive color scheme than a lot of the other combiners, and I think that helped.
Yeah, I think Superion's color scheme probably is a little tighter. Just, I think so, because he's mostly white and blue in the middle. But Predaking looks great. And especially in individual pieces, you could put Predaking on a table, all broken up into its constituent parts, and then you would have no problem saying which robots are part of this set. All of the Scramble City toys, though, except for maybe Abominus, they could all pretty much, I mean, literally, they could interchange.
Sure.
But you could easily be confused. You could say, well, these aerial bots, probably some of these may go into this Defensor set, you know, because, you know, it's a jet. One, you know, this is there's a helicopter. You know, why couldn't you have a jet in here? One of those things. So,
never really thought of it that way. That's interesting.
I mean, as a kid, I didn't have. I only had Computron complete, so I had to mix and match.
Yeah, I never had a complete. I never had any of the Scramble City combiners complete. I think I managed to assemble one piecemeal, but yeah, never a whole one.
My Bruticus had a center twin leg up until I was an adult.
Oh, awesome.
That's yeah. Badass. Yes.
I think the only ones I had was I had at some brief moment Devastator before I lost like some crucial piece, and then I think Abominus maybe also for a brief shining moment, but otherwise I'm in the same boat as you guys. I just had pieces.
So Computron was complete, Bruticus was missing one piece, and I never had Blastoff until I was an adult, and Abominus was missing two pieces. So I think I gave up one of the legs, so I pretty much had
Center Twin?
No. The one that's the shark. I can't.
Ripper Snapper.
Ripper Snapper, yes. I had Ripper Snapper, Center Twin, and Hunger, and that was it.
You didn't have Blot, and what was the other one?
The Vulture was.
Who's that guy?
He's a Griffin, I think. Brain's not working. Some podcast Transformers fans.
Yeah, some fans we are. To Wiki. Let me see here.
Look that up.
Cutthroat.
Cutthroat, yeah.
Great names, by the way. Except for Blot.
Yes.
But he's great.
Blot's awesome. Blot's awesome.
Speaking of names, I just figured I may as well bring this up. I really liked in the Botshot Stunicon set, I like the name Breakneck. I just don't like it in the same set with Breakdown.
Yeah,
that's pretty confusing.
Yeah,
but it is a nice save, I guess, by the copywriters.
I need to pick that up. I'm tired of bot shots, though. I never thought I could say that, but there's just not enough diversity.
Yeah, I understand they said they were going to try and bring some new things into the line next year, and I'll be interested to see what they are. But it's not something I ever expected to have all of. So I've got a couple. I want to get Jetfire just because the Jetfire looks really neat, and I'll probably call it
there. I'm the guy that never got tired of spy changers. How can I say that there's no diversity in bot shots? That makes no sense. Makes no sense. So actually, bot shots are kind of a collect-em-all sort of thing. My favorite collect-em-all, again, are the Creons. I love them. And the Wave 2 blind pack assortment have hit retail in the U.S., so.
Who's in that?
Oh, gosh. We have...
calling you out.
God. So we have a bludgeon in that kit.
Oh, really? Oh, yeah. I've seen his a close-up of his face.
Gosh. We have... I'm just going to have to cheat.
There you are.
Yeah, I knew bludgeon's in there.
It's like...
Springer, Warpath.
Yeah.
Let's go to tformers.com.
Springer, Inferno, maybe? Rampage, Insecticon... Second Hook, Warpath,
Rampage. No, Rampage. Here. Rampage, though, is it a different Rampage?
I think that's Wave 1. Is that Wave 1?
No. Blast Off, Hook. Oh, Hook's in here. Sweet. Dirge, Arachnid, and again, Bludgeon.
It's random.
Yeah. Oh, these were found at Walgreens. Hmm. I know they were found at Target. Walkie found them in Target.
Hmm. I wonder if there's a price difference these days, like usual.
I have, like, okay, don't judge me. I have, like, 24 of the coupons that came out of the newspaper, so hopefully I can get these for free.
You're going to save big? Is that what you're saying?
Yes. I think those expire at the end of January. Kim's going to have to go to Walmart and get those for me. I think it's one per customer, so I'm going to have to go in, like, multiple trips.
Multiple costumes, multiple...
No, just multiple multiple checkouts. No. It'll be like extreme couponing nerd style.
Wish we'd gotten those coupons on this around here, but I never did find them.
So, yeah.
What is the coupon for?
What's the free blind Creon? Yeah, free blind pack.
Free?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, Kim's extreme couponing strategy is there's a local freebie paper... that's, published here. She'll go and she'll go to the supermarket and grab one. Then we'll go to the next supermarket and grab one. Then we'll go to the next and so on and so forth.
Mm.
Yeah. That's how they do it. That's how they rack up those, $600 tickets at the supermarket for free. Never watch Extreme Couponers, by the way, that show, Extreme Coupon. It's like the dregs of society. It's like... It's like people from my hometown. I don't know how everyone on that show just like screams like Northwestern North Carolina, but they do. In fact,
they always have like 700 rolls of toilet paper too.
Oh yeah,
that's the one thing they bulk up on.
It's their stockpile. They're proud of it. Mm-hmm. I'll be honest. So here, yeah. So if you look here to my right. You'll see a shelf that has, you can see Starscream on it from San Diego Comic-Con a couple years ago. That shelf was meant for Kim's stockpile.
Awesome.
Now it's meant for my Transformers, my video game systems.
So she had big plans? She was going to be one of these people?
Yeah. In fact, if she could actually pull it off, I would let her quit her job. But until then, no.
Because it could offset what she makes.
Oh, yeah.
Savings.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That would be awesome. Okay, enough of that. Let's go ahead and jump to a review of the Maiden Japan Junkion set. Now, which set was this, John?
Yes. So this is set A, which came out after set B. And they both came out this year. This is the set that is, I think it goes best with Rekgar, and the other set, set B, I think goes best with Junkheap, but they go great on any one of these, any version of the Junkions that you may happen to have laying around. So as you'll see in the review, it's a neat kit. It doesn't really, it's a neat kit. Okay, so I'll stress the word kit, as you'll see in the review. And then also, you'll see that price is something that you'll probably have to decide on whether or not you want this kit. But you will have to decide pretty quick, because I know the first set is essentially sold out. You can only get it on the secondary market. And I think this second kit that I review this week is probably not going to be around too much longer either.
Cool. And let's see here. Rob and XV have, like I said, a review of Soundblaster. That's going to be awesome. Looking forward to that. And a couple other things, the John Barber interview. So we'll be back after these reviews and the interview with the third-party roundup.
Junkions, robots, motorcycles, garbage. Endless possibilities for troop building based on single frames of animation from 1986. What more could a geek want? But alas, we've only had three official versions of this toy in the main lines. Rekgar from Reveal the Shield, Scrapheap from United, and Junkheap, who looks like Rekgar. So much for variety. Enter Made in Japan, the small, and I do mean small, third-party studio, who started as one guy on a board selling new Junkion armor and new head sculpts to create new Junkions. Until this year, getting these great add-ons was a little tedious and largely done by ordering a la carte off a parts buffet. But now Made in Japan has gone a little bit big time and started offering pre-selected sets and mass-producing them. Presto, instant new third-party Junkions. Now, two sets have been released so far, both in 2012. Don't get confused. Set B came first. Set A, which we'll review here, came second. While any Junkion works with these parts, I'd recommend Junkheap with set A and Rekgar with set B. Color schemes work very well. Each set so far comes with the same array of armor, one shoulder pad, chest plate, waist, two knee pads, an axe, spiked wheel, shield thing, and of course, a new head. First quality, this is not first party stuff. Make no mistake. These sets have a rubbery resin feel, and the molding isn't crisp, so everything kind of has a slight rounding to it. They definitely look handmade, very much like a garage resin kit, but they're also very solid. They have a nice weight to them, and they blend nicely with the toy. Each piece clips firmly into place, knee and shoulder pads, waist, new head, weapons. The only warning I have is with the chest plate. When you apply it, it can put pressure on those two spiky thingies on Rekgar's chest, so use care when applying it. And ta-da, in a matter of seconds, literally seconds, you finally have this guy. Or maybe this guy. Or is it that guy? Hell, I don't know. But he is cool, and the quality is very, very nice. The feel of the plastic, definitely not Hasbro quality, but overall it does blend nicely, and it does create a very convincing new Junkion. Who doesn't love that? Last thing you may not love, price. This kit runs around $55 online. That's before shipping. And add the cost of a Rekgar, and that's another $15 to $20. You're looking at $75 and up for a new Junkion. Pretty pricey, but it's worth it if you're into this sort of junk.
Did not end this last week. Two fearless Radio Free Cybertron reviewers are back once again to bring you more Rescue Bots short reviews. Yay! I am Amy.
I am Nick. Hi.
And today we are reviewing Rescue Bots episode 20 titled Countdown. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
10.
Okay, so as Frankie is chasing after her dogs who are chasing Dither, they bump into Doc Green, who is taking inventory in the warehouse where all of the inventions are kept. And the dogs bump over this canister with these little robot bugs in them. And that's when the trouble starts.
Scraplets.
Yeah, kind
They're
of.
A mixture of scraplets and parasprites. For all you My Little Pony fans out there, you know what I'm talking about.
We're getting our digs in as little bit as we can. But please, keep watching. We're going to review Transformers.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, goodness. So as Frankie turns the corner, her dad is suddenly gone and she goes to look for him. Meanwhile, the bugs get out and suddenly the town start to disappear. The people of the town, oh no. And everywhere the bugs go, people just start to pop and they're disappeared. But no one sees what happens. It's just like the fact that they are just not there when they go to look for them. We get campers disappearing, leaving fires burning, and the rescue team has to go put it out. We get calls from...
You know, Smokey would be so upset.
Oh, he totally would be.
He'd be like, Smokey's not happy about that.
You're not helping! They get calls from people about swarms of bugs on the phone, and then they're like, then they go dead or whatever because like people on the other end are like, there's bugs everywhere! And then boom, they're gone. Boats in the bay are bumping into each other because no one is driving them. And Chief, they're right at the situation where the semi-truck is going amok because there's no driver. And he disappears. And it's
not Chief.
Just like everybody else in town. And they're like, no, where's Chief? Where is he? And Chase is like, I don't know. I just turned around and he was gone. So, ideas. Their first response is, it's the shrink ray, which is great that they referenced the previous episode. Mm-hmm. So I was like, yeah, that's cool that they referenced previous continuity. So, yeah. But it's also at that point when they're trying to figure out what's going on that they finally see a person disappear right in front of them from these little boogers that are like, you know, making people go blink and they're blinking out. So what are they? Where do they come from? And where are all the people going when they disappear? And how do we get them back? Yeah, that's when things go a little sci-fi. We get quantum crystals and teleportation, and Graham explains that at one point. Yeah,
there's so many sci-fi things, so many references. And no matter whatever sci-fi, if you're a Star Wars fan, Star Trek fan, Stargate, you're going to find something in this episode that you can relate to.
Yeah, so. Yeah. Graham explains at one point in the episode that in the 1950s, scientists were using crystals to open large space wormholes, subspace wormholes. Yay! and as Graham tries to explain it all, the bug they captured wakes up and sends Graham into the big nowhere too. Oh no! So where everybody else is, he shows up and they're like, oh, okay, it's in a cave and they're under the city somewhere and it gets worse. They're running out of air because they never finished building this cavern and it's highly unstable. So they're like, oh, we've got some conflict here and it's really bad. So everyone but a few people are left. We've got Cody, we've got Cade, we've got Frankie, and the bots aren't affected because the bugs are only designed to nab humans. So who's left? Mm-hmm. Who do we call? Professor Baranova.
Ghostbusters?
Ghostbusters? No.
They're already busting their own ghosts.
That's the next episode. We call them Ghostbusters next episode.
I was glad to see her back, though.
Yeah, it was good to have her back. Because she's like, you know, she's helping out. She's got information that they need.
Mm-hmm. And she's still looking as good as ever.
Absolutely. Her and Doc Green need to get together.
For sure. For sure.
So she informs them that these bugs are called tracers and they're designed to save people in case of a cataclysmic event and transport them to an underground shelter for safety. And they won't stop until their mission has been concluded. So with that information she gave them, they go to research about the sanctuary because she gets zapped and taken to the same place that everybody else is. The big black nothing. Oh no!
Oh no!
But they don't find the information in time before all the humans are transported to unstable sanctuary. Oh, no. So the conflict is like, oh, tell him soon. Ah, and then he's gone. He's like, now the bots have to figure this out on their own. So they do. They find out that they are under the mountain and they go down there and they get him out and, you know, they figure out a way to turn off all the bugs with this sonic boom, but it really didn't matter at that point because all of the people were gone at that point. So they were, you know, they could have just shut off at that point too. So,
yeah.
But yeah, they go and they find them and the day is saved. Yay.
Yay.
The last point I wanted to point out is that Frankie admits to Cody that she is afraid of the dark.
She has a weakness.
That was brave. Yeah. There is a weakness. Frankie has one. And it's the darkness.
And it's not cute dogs. with funny scientific names.
Yeah, like Aristotle and what was the other dog's name? Aristotle and
I can't remember now.
I'd have to look it up. Darn it. Darn dogs and their names. Well, that's our review of Countdown. This has got to be one of my favorite episodes, despite the fact that a little far-fetched that they would have developed something science-y in the 1950s, maybe the 70s or the 90s. I mean, it's 90s isn't too far away at this point. We're in the 2000s, so they could have said it would have been in the 90s. But sci-fi love, I still loved that. It was still a really, really strong episode for me, and I'm really happy with it. So how about you, Nicole?
I love this episode, too. Of course, I say that about every episode. Yeah. It's just fun. Like I said, it's very science fiction-y, and I love that kind, because you're trying to figure out. It's like, okay, I'm going to try to figure this out before the end. It's also a mystery. So, yeah. And I like that. You get into the show. You become part of the show. So.
All right. Mm-hmm. Well, we have not yet reviewed this one over on the Rescue Center, but we will be getting to it very soon. So we've reviewed every other episode prior to this 20th episode, so you can check it out. Check out our reviews at theunderbase.libsyn.com. And thanks for tuning in. So we'll catch you again next week. Yeah. Goodbye.
Aloha. I was about ready to come through the computer and smack Mike. He's making faces.
Is he making faces? Oh, it's a good thing I didn't see that. You know, it might actually crop him out.
See, Mike? There you go. There he goes again. Don't act so innocent, Mike.
It'd be better if he was standing right behind me making these faces. So just keep on walking. Keep on walking.
So, John, welcome. You're on with Nicole Hale, Chris Triplett, and Chris McFeely. Thanks for joining us.
Hey, no problem. Do I have video?
It's not up just yet. We do have a lovely picture of you, though. so you may hit the video button, and we'll get you on. So first of all, it was great to meet you at BotCon. Thanks for coming to BotCon. The IDW panel was really really fantastic. There you are.
Yeah, hi, John. Look back, so nobody can see me.
That's perfect. That's the way to do it. It seems mysterious. Who is this man? Who is
the man in the shadows
on our show? So we just want to talk to you a little bit about what's going on with Transformers IDW, and just first of all, I think on behalf of our crew, I'd like to say thanks for making Transformers awesome.
Yeah.
The relaunch with More Than Meets the Eye and Robots in Disguise has just been dandy.
Thanks. I can't take all the credit. Andy Schmidt set us up on that book and on the books, and James Roberts and Alex Milne are killing on More Than Meets the Eye, and obviously Andrew Griffith's doing a great job on Robots in Disguise. I couldn't be happier to work with anybody but him.
Yeah, it's great.
Literally, as I said the word Andrew Griffith, he just came online on Skype, so his name popped up on my screen.
It's like little Q.
Damn, he is awoken.
Yes.
Speak of the devil.
So first of all, I want to talk about some of the stuff that we saw at BotCon. Of course, not everybody got to see all the pictures and things, but we're a little interested in July, because we hear there's going to be Dinobots and Decepticons and things going on. What if anything can you tell us? I mean, obviously our listeners weren't at the panel, so what can you tell us about it?
July is Decepticon month, so we've got in More Than Meets the Eye, we finally meet the Decepticon Justice Division, which James has been teasing out, I think, since Bullets in the Wreckers trade, last end of the Wreckers trade, for anybody that doesn't religiously follow Transformers. So we'll finally see who they are. They're sort of the ultra loyalists to Megatron. They're they're the ones that go after the Decepticons that go bad. Like they're the sort of the worst of the worst. If you're an Autobot or a rogue Decepticon, so we'll finally get a chance to see them. Meanwhile, in More Than Meets the in Robots in Disguise, the one I write, Turmoil, who was in the Drift one shot and briefly in the Drift Limited series. And was presumed dead, is back, and he's on Cybertron, and Bumblebee and Metalhawk and the whole group has to figure out what to do with this really terrible Decepticon showing up. You know, do they let him in? Do they treat him like a normal Cybertronian? But I think the big news really is August is Dinobot month. That's going to run across all of the Transformers books, including Regeneration 1. And it's not an event that you have to read every, you know, it doesn't start in one and go to the next. Obviously, Regeneration 1 takes place in a totally different universe. It's part of that just actually worked out really coincidentally. you're not going to believe this, but they like Grimlock in Regeneration 1.
Really? I can't imagine why.
I don't know.
So, Simon Furman kind of likes the character, so he's showing up. So we'll have Regeneration 1, we'll have Action Master Grimlock taking center stage.
Ooh.
Meanwhile, in the regular IDW Comics universe, Grimlock's going to be coming back. We haven't seen him since he disappeared from Garrus 9. That was about... It was about 5 years in continuity. I think it was a little bit less in real time. So we haven't seen him for a very long time. We don't know what he's been up to, and he's going to be showing up in More Than Meets the Eye. And meanwhile, the rest of the Dinobots are going to be returning to Cybertron and Robots in Disguise, and Ironhide's going to be leading them into the Cybertronian wilderness, so we'll finally get a chance to explore what's going on outside of Iacon and the farther reaches of Cybertron.
Excellent. Oh, well, I mean, obviously we're looking forward to it. So, I did just get a chance. I've been so busy after BotCon, but I did get a chance to catch up on Robots in Disguise. I'm kind of interested. I mean, is it your intention? I mean, was it your intention to sort of create sort of almost like a political drama and do that in like the Transformers world, or what is your sort of your vision for Robots in Disguise? I mean, what are you thinking on it?
Yeah, I mean, it's a political story, but it's political in the sense that, like, I don't know, maybe Game of Thrones is political. There isn't a lot of people walking down hallways. Hopefully it isn't a lot of people walking down hallways and talking.
No.
And,
not that.
No.
it's a lot of fighting.
There's less nudity as well, I think.
In game, well, they're all naked.
Oh, yeah. That's a good point. Fair point, sir.
We're one of the few comics out there that has 100% nudity ratio. the idea is sort of what happens after the good guys win. How do you win a battle that's lasted for 4 million years? There's no easy ways to maintain a victory and still be the good guys. You know. And Bumblebee is sort of the key figure in that he's essentially the good guy. He's the nice guy who's sort of put into this position where he has to do not nice things, you know, for the good of everybody. doors are moving behind me. the questions of how far do you go, you know, for good.
Prowl is definitely, you know, sort of crossing that line. I mean, he's gone into a whole, you know, different thing. I have to say, the death of the Constructicons was just a little, oh, I was like, wow, we went there. So, I mean, so bravo to that, though. I mean,
I genuinely thought issue 4 was where everybody would turn against me.
Well, definitely, it's definitely raised a lot of hackles.
Yeah.
All right. I do have one question about, of course, since you're kind of senior editing everything, More Than Meets the Eye I've been really interested in as well. Is it the Odyssey? Because that's been my question from the beginning, because it's like I got to the end of the first series, like, oh my god, it's the Odyssey! Is it really, or am I just making that up?
I don't think you're far off. I mean, it's a quest. It's a mm-hmm. quest narrative. I mean, James... You kind of have to ask James Roberts, the writer, about some of his influences, but that's definitely the sort of thing James thinks about. You know, not to sound too lofty with this stuff, but I think both of us had goals that would be more than just, you know, big robots fighting. Although we both want there to be big robots fighting, because it is a key part of Transformers. But in addition to that, you can kind of take it, you know, hopefully further than a lot of Transformers comics have gone before. Not there haven't been some you know, great ones in the past, but, you know, both of us just want to really, you know, push it, try something new. And I think, mine's really sort of grounded and centered on this one location. James is really taking him on this voyage through the galaxy. We'll see pieces of the past and the future and all these things as we keep going. The two books really have a different feel. I think James, you know, The Odyssey is not far, you know, it's not far from what from what he's going for, from what we're going for with it.
I'll take that as a yes. Okay.
I wondered, was that a conscious choice when the books were being mapped out or later in the process? Was it a conscious decision to have one that is very much the out there voyaging, exploring the world, and one that is the very insular, totally limited to Cybertron thing, and to deliberately explore these two things in two separate books, or did they just sort of happen that way? I mean, was it planned out, or...?
Yeah, I mean, that was the idea was, you know, okay, there's one group that's going out into space and one group that's staying on the planet. We'd been focused on Earth for so long, we wanted to kind of move away from being on Earth for a while. And there's sort of two ways you could not be on Earth, which is be somewhere else or be traveling through space. So, yes, and then I think James and I approached the stuff from some different angles. Like, we come at this from different paths, different histories with the Transformers and different ways of looking at the stuff. I think we kind of arrive at a similar place because I mean, I really love what James does, and he tells me he likes what I do. I don't know.
It couldn't be just because you're like the editor, right? It's not like...
we talk, we usually have pretty long conversations every couple weeks, you know, just kind of talk about what you're like writer, like as a writer to writer kind of thing. That was the editor writer, you know, relationship. Just kind of figure out what we want to do, where we're going to go with things. So we talk about the stuff. We kind of, you know, there's definitely pieces that he's you know, thrown my way that have become major parts of Robots in Disguise. So there's, you know, there's a little bit of the DNA of each of us kind of seeping into the other books. But what really keeps them separate, I think, is that we come at them differently. Mm. And I think if the genesis was deliberate in having one going off and one staying behind. And I think there would have been more deliberate course correction if we'd started to do things too similarly, but that just didn't really happen.
Cool. Well, I know Nicole just has a burning question. So
I do, but it's not about Transformers.
Okay.
When you worked for Marvel, I want to ask you a question, because you were the original editor of one of my favorite comics, the Dark Tower series. Oh. And I was wondering, how did you get involved with Stephen King? What kind of permissions did you have to deal with him? I mean, everyone knows Stephen King. So what was your involvement with him?
It's kind of an interesting story. The senior editor on the book was Ralph Macchio. We basically just listed our actual positions in the company. So I was editor, but like Ralph was a big, you know, big part of the editing process. And then Nicole Boos, now, I can't remember if she was Nicole Wiley at the time, associate editor.
I got the book right here.
Okay. The three of us were editorially. But how it actually started...
She's Boos
okay.
At that time.
Good. Going after Stephen King was something that I think Joe Quesada had wanted to do for a really long time, and he'd, over the years, had made some inroads with King's agent and King's people and stuff. And finally, we sort of got it set up where we were going to pitch on doing this Dark Tower series. So Joe wanted it to be, you know, all out. We're going to get some of the best people we could and not make it just a regular adaptation or a spin-off book that you see in a lot of comic companies. So we initially, Joe wrote an outline of, I think it was like 4 pages. He just broke down the opening scene of, or the opening sentence or paragraph of The Gunslinger with a Roland running through the desert with the man in black mm-hmm. pursuing. So Joe wrote a plot. It was a 4-page plot, and we sent it over to Jay Lee. And the idea was that Jay was going to pencil it. Richard Isenov was going to digitally paint it. At the same time, Jay was going to ink it, and then Isenov would color it more traditionally. So we'd have sort of 2 versions to show at this presentation that we'd arranged to have, you know, King and his agent Ralph Vincenzia show up. Was it Ralph? Yeah. Jay turned in the, you know, pencils. They were really cool. Richard painted the first page, and we were like, "Oh no, that's it. Don't ink them. That's exactly how it's got to look. It's beautiful." So we got that done. Chris Eliopoulos lettered it up. We had him print it out on big 10x15, you know, board to take to this presentation. And this is, again, this is the pitch meeting. There's no contract signed. King and his agent come into the conference room, and it was me, Ralph, Nicole, Dan Buckley, Joe Quesada, Tom Marvelli, who's the head of creative services at Marvel, you know, just a bunch of people kind of sitting around this conference table. We show King these pages, and he's looking at them. And I think Joe said something like, "Okay, so now these are just sample pages. We won't actually use these." And King's like, "No, these are the first four pages of the book." Then he turned the page, and here's what happens. He lays out 30 issues right there.
Wow!
He was really awesome. He was great. He's like kind of exactly how you hope Stephen King is. Like, he's just a really nice guy. He surrounds himself with really cool people.
I would not been able to talk in that meeting and be like, "Oh my gosh, it's you."
Those were the first pages of the Dark Tower book. That was the course he took for the next 30 issues. I only worked in the I worked in the first story, and then I kind of helped break down the story in the second one. But that was how it went. It went really smoothly.
It's gorgeous. I love it. It's one of my favorite trades I'll put together is that first one. It's like beautiful. I love it. You guys did a great job. It's my favorite story of all time, so the series of books, so it's like, this is great.
Thanks a lot. Yeah, look, we're really aware we're going to get a lot of people who had never read comics before or hadn't read comics for a really long time, so we wanted to have something that was going to be accessible to them, but not in a way a lot of things wind up, when you say being accessible, a lot of times you just wind up with the most basic storytelling, and we wanted something that was going to be very unique and comics-y, and Jay and Richard really delivered that.
Well, it's what got me back into comic book reading, so congratulations.
Well, that's awesome.
And now I do a podcast about comic books.
So now I thank you.
Awesome.
That's great. I'm glad to hear that.
So I know you don't have a lot of time, but we want to talk real quick about Regeneration 1, because, of course, the .5 came out with Free Comic Book Day yesterday.
Yeah.
I had a great Free Comic Book Day, so I hope you did as well. So Regeneration 1, this is kind of something that maybe is a little bit different, because this really came about as a large part from fan reaction. Were you surprised by the fan reaction to try to get this done?
Yes and no. I mean, Simon's writing affected a lot of people. When I was a kid, I grew up and I read Transformers. I mean, I bought the first Transformers off the stand. I love the series, but I probably liked what Larry Hama was doing on G.I. Joe more, and like that. You know, I was one of those people that stuff really affected me. The Silent Issue and the second year of it, where Cobra started getting really complex, and the fact that in the G.I. Joe comics, like, all these guys were Vietnam vets, and they were all really. They were sort of damaged people who would go off on these killing missions, and they knew they weren't all going to make it back. It was really different in the cartoon. And I love the Transformers comic, but I stopped reading it at a certain point. And I was living in England for a while, and my friends there that were about the same age that would be talking about G.I. Joe if we were in the U.S. would be talking about Transformers. And I kind of, I was kind of surprised. I mean, I guess it translates a little better across across countries and stuff than G.I. Joe does, maybe. A friend of mine, Daniel Merlin Goodbury, was like, "Oh, you've got to check out Simon Furman's stuff." So I did, and I was the first issue I read. This is in like my mid 20s, this wasn't that long ago, cosmically speaking. It was the one with Ratchet and Megatron fused together, and they've just come out of the teleporter device, and they're kind of walking down the hallway, screaming and begging to be killed. And I was like, "Wow, this is awesome!" If I was like 10 when I saw this, this would have changed my life. And I think that's the effect that Simon's stuff had on a lot of people, that were reading it at that time, or that read it later. I mean, like, I love that stuff, and I have absolutely no nostalgia for it. I just really, really enjoy it. I think knowing that, and knowing the. Knowing how the Joe fans responded so positively to having Larry continue the G.I. Joe story with Real American Hero, it's not exactly surprising, but the number of people and the excitement about it was certainly impressive.
Not to ask a hard question, but do you think it's any bit of a risk, in a sense, because... I think there's a lot of vocal fans who were really, excited about getting it, but do you think there's any bit of a risk of trying to, it's sort of like catching lightning in a bottle again, maybe, or something like that? I don't feel that way because I read it and I love it, but just kind of as a company question, I guess, from an editorial standpoint, maybe.
Absolutely. There's I can say this because I've read the next issues and I know this doesn't happen, but there's every chance in the world that you'd come in and do do something that just it doesn't live up to the legacy. Or, I mean, even worse, it's not, you're not only fighting against the actual comics that came out, but people's memories of it. You know, you're sort of up against people's childhood. I mean, it's sort of the unwinnable situation of, like, Star Wars prequels or something, that, like, you have people that have been thinking about Star Wars literally as long as they've lived, and there's no way you're going to be able to go up against not only the actual quality of the movies, but the but every single thought that person has ever thought in their entire life. Mm-hmm. There's that danger. You know, can you go home again? Can you come back and do something? I think Simon, Andrew, Stephen Baskerville, Ed Wildman, the artist. I mean, those are the exact same three people who were writing and drawing the issue 80, and they're all back. And they really brought their A game to it. I mean, it's not like those guys haven't been doing Transformers over the years either. So it's not like they're coming in and just hitting the ground, you know, without having done this for 20 years. That is definitely a risk. It was definitely something I was worried about. But then I think what actually has happened with the book is pretty extraordinary. I think Simon's not one to not take risks. Mm-hmm. And I think as the story goes on, it isn't a nostalgia fest. It's very much, okay, here's what happens after that. You know, here's you had issue 80, but here's what happens next, and it's not what you thought was going to happen, and you know, some of it's pretty terrible. terrible for the characters, not qualitatively terrible.
Well, and he said dead is dead as well. I think that was the thing that really, I think, captured a lot of attention at the panel as well. And when, you know, he mentioned that you know, that was always the thing where it's like you'd have someone die and then they came back, but he said this is going to be the definitive. I mean, is that, I don't know, I mean, that kind of blows me away a little bit, because it's like, that sounds scary and yet exciting. Because we are in a different world now. I mean, and that's, and it, I like that, you know, as far as IDW, they've made, you know, several mentions that they understand that, you know, you're walking that line where it's like you want to try to recapture what happened 20 years ago, and yet, you know, comics have changed in 20 years. People's expectations have changed. So how do you, you know, meld those two things? I will say, after reading the point five, it's like, oh, that's how you do it.
The point five is probably the most, I mean, it's intentionally a recap of the series. So, mm-hmm. like, in that sense, it's the one that really looks back the most. The rest of it doesn't really look back that way. You know, it keeps moving things forward. I think the series really gets better and better. I'm glad to hear you like the 80.5. I just think that's not the peak.
Oh, no. And I think it's just, I think it was the right way to set it up, you know, to really kind of to lay that foundation. I mean, it's one of those deals where, and I think I may have mentioned this to Chris Triplett yesterday, but it's like, I knew what was going to happen, like, after the first page, and I liked that I knew that. Mm. You know, it felt comfortable. It's like, okay, I'm like, I understand this world, and it's going to be messed up and awesome. And I like that. So I think Furman, was that an offhand comment, or he scripted out to like 20 issues or more for this? I mean, do you know about how far out you're?
The goal is issue 100.
So awesome.
Yeah.
That would be great.
And I think that's, you know, that's a big part of what he means when he says dead is dead we're aiming for an ending with this. Mm-hmm. You know, there's something that, like, it's all set up where we're going and what Simon's doing. I mean, there's plenty of room for Simon to riff on things, I think, as he goes on.
Talking about goals, is it your goal to kill off more Transformers than Simon Furman?
It'll be a race. don't leave James out. James isn't innocent in this either.
No, there's, and that's why I kind of made that Odyssey reference as well, because it's like, man, it's like we're killing everybody. We're killing somebody at least every issue. You know,
well, James has only killed guys who don't have toys. There's an important distinction there.
Oh, well, John, we know we want to let you go. We thank you so much for coming. We're really excited. Awesome. Like I said, Robots in Disguise, World of the MCI, have just been great. We're looking forward to getting Regenerations in our hand. That's going to come July, and then we've got Decepticons in July and Dinobots in August. So lots of awesome stuff coming out of Transformers IDW. We are looking forward to it. John, thanks again. Thanks so much for coming on the show. We really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks for supporting us, and congratulations on 100 episodes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Bye.
Hey everybody, it's RAC from FigureReviews.com.
This week, I'm looking at Fall of Cybertron Soundblaster with Buzzsaw. First things first, sadly, the packaging never uses the name New Soundwave. Even so, the reference to being rebuilt on another planet after being salvaged by his minions is a pretty clear headmaster shout-out. Like 2010's Cybertronian Soundwave and the Soundwave in this Voyager assortment, Soundblaster adheres to the War for Cybertron design. While it lacks the distinctive dull squareness of G1 Soundwave, that's not exactly a bad thing. Soundblaster is big, even compared to some other Voyagers. He looks like an absolute monster next to this year's Deluxes. Which means this figure makes a little more sense to get than Soundwave, since he's supposed to have been rebuilt into a frontline fighter. And hey, you finally got a figure in scale with Cybertronian Bumblebee. But even better, he's big and solid, and feeling much more like a 2010 Voyager than a current figure. The 2010 feeling extends to articulation. Soundblaster has a limited neck, but otherwise has at least decent range at all points, though this is achieved with cheaty hinges in the upper arm to accommodate for the odd shoulder shape. Among the highlights are the ability to kneel and some excellent arm articulation that, coupled with a sculpted index finger, allows him to reach his own eject button. Speaking of which, Soundblaster has an eject button. His torso is a big hollow tube that allows him to hold several minions. Disc minions. The backplate acts as a plunger, and it gets pretty far out from the figure when he's fully loaded. Buzzsaw, the included disc, has a tendency to get stuck unless he's angled just so. It has its quirks, but the disc feature is fun, and you could ignore it entirely and you'd still have a satisfying figure. Transformation's very much like the Deluxe, though of course the plunger changes things a little bit. None of it is complicated enough to be vexing, and not unduly simple for its size either. But make sure you angle the windshield properly. It's meant to tab into the space above it. The result is a decent-looking, you could even say toothsome, communications truck. It has what looks like a seat on top that's probably just a lever for the plunger instead, but I want to get Rumble and test that. But the plunger is good to have because Soundblaster can still eject discs in vehicle mode. Where Soundwave includes Laserbeak, Soundblaster gets G1 Soundwave's pack-in Buzzsaw, who is represented here as a golden disc. Yes. It auto-transforms when it hits the ground or when you press on it, and it makes it about as good a disc-shaped condor as the G1 mold did a cassette-shaped condor. I wish he had feet, and painted optics would help. But it's decent, and it fits in Soundblaster's chest with some fiddling. Soundblaster also has his shoulder cannon, even though the G1 Optimus Prime rifle seen on the package didn't cost out. Soundblaster would still be the best Voyager I've gotten this year if he didn't have Buzzsaw, who is touchy but doesn't bring the whole package down. This figure feels out of place among the other 2012 Transformers in a very good way, and though it may be foolish, I'm hoping this means 2013 is off to a good start. I don't know that it's worth owning both Soundwave and Soundblaster, but you should definitely get one. He's easily excellent on the figurereviews.com non-numeric rating scale, and you can read the full text review with extensive photos at tformers.com now.
Radio Free Cybertron will return after these messages.
Bottom of the sea come the monsters of the deep, the Target Master Seacons. When they join with their leader to form Piranacon, anyone can become the gun. And here come the Sparkabots.
And when the fighting man is these sparks all fly, and the fire comes out of the Sparkabots.
Each sold separately.
You can hear our show on Stitcher Smart Radio. Stitcher allows you to listen to your favorite shows directly from your iPhone, Android phone, BlackBerry, or Palm phones. On demand and on the go. Don't have Stitcher? Download it for free today at Stitcher.com or in the app stores. Stitcher Smart Radio, the smarter way to listen to radio.
Battle after battle in the sky. The Autobots create the ultimate robot jet. Jetfire.
Transformers, more than meets the eye.
But the evil Decepticons have a secret new weapon. Shockwave.
The Transformers,
robots in disguise.
Transformers from Hasbro.
We now return to Radio Free Cybertron.
We are back. It's time for the third party roundup. Like I said, like I teased in the beginning of the show, I think the biggest news item this week was actually a third party news item. And correct me if I'm wrong, guys, but this really excites me. So Fans Project had the Toys for Tots deal a couple weeks ago. It expired Saturday or Sunday, I think, maybe it might have been Monday, where you buy the toy, they would give $20 to Toys for Tots. It was $69.99, I think, and all they could say, it was going to be a robot, had four wheels. They didn't tell you what it was. So it turns out it was the Function X1, which is the NOT Chromedome, and it looks freaking awesome. I want this.
It looks awesome if you're part of that camp on the internet.
Yeah, I want it.
Very polarizing.
It is polarizing. I want it. As I said in the email to you guys, Fortress Maximus is not the only one who's come himself.
Oh my god. Oh, yes, yes. So you're saying you like it.
I like it. Uh-huh. It's really nice.
I'm going to be honest with you.
You don't like it.
I'm on the other side.
Yeah, I think it looks great. Yeah, I think maybe some different paint apps on the head, or maybe just a slight color correction. But I like it. I'm in love with this thing. I want it.
Are you a Chrome Dome guy?
I like Chrome Dome.
I mean, that doesn't hurt.
Yeah.
You know, I'm just... I definitely think there's something about the head the head and the feet. There's something about the head and the feet that I'm not wild about, but I think more than anything, just for me, just personally, is that for some reason he feels a little bit more like a garage kit. He gives off like a garage kit aesthetic and vibe versus like an actual toy, but that's just me. I can definitely see.
Maybe it's like a more strict homage to like the Headmasters, because those are the blockiest block formers Samad that we ever got.
It certainly is. It's not attempting to be like a classics Chrome Dome so much as like Chrome Dome with modern technology, you know? I mean, like a G1 Chrome Dome with stuff that we can do today. No more, no less.
Yeah, it's a pretty well on model Chrome Dome, and Chrome Dome was pretty square. So
yeah, they're all square. I mean, they're all just abysmal. But I still love them. I can't help it.
So are you regretting that you didn't get in on this deal, or was that a little bit too spicy of a
meatball? Well, I didn't know what it was going to be. I haven't read anything that said that this isn't going to be available outside of that offer, right? They're not. I mean, this is like their next big thing.
I think so. I think they're going to launch the four or so.
Yeah, it's their next big thing. They're not going to just launch that entirely as a Toys for Tots deal.
Mm-hmm.
I can't see it. So actually, that's the that's sort of like the next item in the news. So there's lots of stuff they're doing. So what all are they doing? My favorite thing is the Skull Cruncher. They're doing Skull Cruncher painted as Optimus Prime, so he can be the frickin' City of Steel Alligator Con. That's amazing. Sure.
That is pretty neat. It's a cool sense of humor too, because they do take a slight risk in running a bunch of them, which may or may not sell, but they're cool, and it's something that obviously Hasbro wouldn't do ever, but they're cool. So let's see here, you get they're even doing the Decepticons. I forgot.
Is that Nightbeat? That's Nightbeat, isn't it?
It'll probably be Nightbeat.
Okay.
Ultimately.
Yeah. Yeah, they're even doing a couple of Decepticons at least. So, Weird Wolf and Ratbat, which is cool.
Yeah, this is great. I'm excited. I guess we've already gotten too many hardheads as of recent. Hardhead, you know, he's okay. I think Chrome Dome is long past his due, though.
Well, that's the iconic headmaster, so to speak. Yeah, he's got the cult following. he's kind of represented.
I think Brainstorm is long overdue as well.
You think so?
Oh, yeah. Brainstorm's just a nice, he's just a nice looking robot, a decent jet. Actually, is he in the set? Let me go back and look. Yes, actually he is, the mold. It's, what was he repainted as in Japan?
Who?
Brainstorm.
I don't know.
Because that's here, you can see the mouse. That is the Brainstorm design there. I just don't know who it's going to be.
Who was he repainted? Right.
No, the color scheme is just wrong. It's nice looking.
Yeah, it could be just a huge departure.
Could be. That could be it. That could be it. In fact, I don't remember him being repainted as anything.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. I don't know if they ever used that mold. Nothing jumps to mind. It's just... the colors are just very different. He was a whole heck of a lot more.
He was teal. Aqua teal. Yeah, I love that toy. It's a great toy. But yeah, so we'll have to see. I think this is the coolest thing. This is, and honestly, the price that it looks like they're charging for these is going to be comparable to a loose Headmaster. So if you're going to get, like, a loose Brainstorm, you're probably going to be dropping... It's in decent shape. You're probably going to be dropping $70-$80.
I don't know anymore, buddy. I'll be honest with you. I was looking at that... Actually, I was looking at this stuff this weekend on eBay. And I had to... I was so upset I had to tweet. I tweeted the... again, how sad it is, the state of G1 prices. They're so low, it feels like they deserve better. It's odd. It's really strange. I saw a like new Trax. So G1 Trax with the packaging, the bubble was opened with a razor, so he looks sealed, blah 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 blah, all that good stuff. And the auction had been on for like 3 or 4 days, and he was at like $50, I think, 60 yeah. maybe, and that was like a $500 toy 7 years ago.
It's been reissued, so
I know it's but even stuff like Misfire. Okay, so like Misfire, same thing. Like people won't pay you $100 for essentially mint in box Misfire. They won't do it.
The prices fluctuate. I mean, it's. Like, I bought, like, in 99, had to be 99, because I didn't have a computer yet. I think I bought it on eBay at school. I got a mitten box. The box was beat up, but it's a mitten box Galvatron for, like, $30. Galvatron is phenomenal. He was just missing his rifle. And that was, like, in the heyday of stuff being, like, too expensive. It's just, it's really volatile. I mean, it just depends on who's looking at it at the time, how good the photos are, just and basically... You just got to luck out. Like, you'll go and look at completed auctions. One thing might be $15. One thing might be $70.
Which makes pricing things really kind of difficult when yes. you go to sell.
Yes. Oh, believe me, I have hundreds of stuff in my closet right now that I'm trying to get rid of. I don't know if I'm going to get thousands of dollars or dozens of dollars.
On a completely unrelated note, I saw that, this is weird, but I also decided to search for Dino Riders, and like the two holy grails of Dino Riders were on eBay in the last month, for all you toy fans out there. It was the Brontosaurus and the T-Rex, sealed, and both of them went for about $1,000 each.
Gah!
Wow.
Yeah. Two Brontosauri. Each went for like 900 something, and then the T-Rex went for like 900.
If someone can get me a USS flag from G.I. Joe for $50, let me know. Yeah, G.I. Joe I don't think is... Actually, G.I. Joe is suffering from the same thing Transformers is.
I think a lot of it is actually that people are liquidating their collections to make some extra money, and there's just more on the market than there used to be.
That's true.
Yeah.
And nice stuff, like I said. Like, you mm-hmm. can search eBay and see lots of, like, traditionally high-dollar stuff in numbers on eBay right now. So, what you gonna do? But then you get the weird stuff, like toy lines contemporary to Transformers, like Dino Riders. It's still, like, scarce. Like, it's like people don't sell their collections. So, when stuff pops up, you get the frenzy that we used to have. when stuff went up on auction.
I was looking at Roboplastic Apocalypse, Crazy Steve's website, actually the Facebook page for, which if you're not a fan of that that Facebook page, why not? It's awesome. I keep linking to that, and a couple people here and there will like it. It's like some of the best stuff on the internet. Go read it. But he had posted a couple of RoboForce cases that were just recently uncovered. RoboForce is one of those things where there's not like a lot of pent-up demand for it, except from me. So it means that if I really wanted to get it, I could probably snag the whole series. But I just recently got a Max Steel, and he's the most iconic. It's like if you just have to have one, get Max Steel, mm-hmm. and you're good.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I would like to have. I would like look. I would like to peer into that case and see what's in there.
Okay, so Brian, real quick, just because you brought it up, and this is like price fluctuation right here. I think. Oh, actually, never mind. The USS Flag. So there's been quite a few on eBay, and it looks like the low end is $1,000, and a couple of them have gone for
$2,500. Wow.
And that's mint in box. And I would, unboxed would be probably even a bigger pain to ship to you and deliver to you. So.
I know a guy's got like five of them. I'm gonna wait for him to like go broke,
and then hand him like $200.
Yeah. God, I don't really even want it. I don't have room for it. It's one of those like nice to haves. But if G.I. Joe ever like catches on with a third party crowd and somebody wants to make a third party flag,
yeah,
let me know.
A Python Patrol flag. How about that?
Oh. That would be awesome.
You know, if you had a mint in box flag, you would display that. You would display the sealed box in a place of honor.
Absolutely, I would. Yeah, it would be on the shelf right now where all my game systems are. But the box is kind of boring looking, though.
Well, but I mean, it's this big kind of. I always thought the G.I. Joe artwork was kind of glorious when it was the best versions of the box art of G.I. Joe. I always thought it was really like, I don't know. Engaging and exciting. I liked it. I always liked the random like hell flame behind everything, and then you know, it was like a piece of art. It was kind of just, I don't know. I enjoyed it. I enjoy G.I. Joe packaging quite a bit.
Yeah, it's pretty nice. Yeah. Okay, and a couple more items. In the third party roundup, but not a huge month for third party stuff, but some neat stuff. So the Planet X Project Genesis, up until recently, we've only seen a prototype in the flat gray. Right now we have, again, it's prototype, but it's G1 colors, and it looks pretty great. It's right here. Apparently, Planet X Genesis is going to be muted a little bit and probably more in line with the Fall of Cybertron colors. But I really like this G1 inspired paint scheme. I really like this. I guess I'll never have it.
I think you're right, though. I think the if it's faithful to the game looks like it's. It looks like this, but like drug through mud.
Yeah.
So I don't know like how great that's going to be. I mean, I'm surprised that there was enough vocal outrage over the G1 colors. Yeah, to change it. That seemed really odd to me. It seemed smart that they would give him G1 colors in the hopes that that would boost sales for people who want him for like their classics collection. Or, you know, I mean, they want Omega Supreme, but they don't really have any kind of tie to the game. But they sure turned around within like a week and just backtracked. It's interesting. You would think they would. The thing is like $350.
God. So
you would think they would say, well, whoever's going to buy it's going to buy it. And by doing G1 colors, we may get a few here and there kind of casual people on the fence to go ahead and buy it. But now that it's going to be a completely War for Cybertron toy. There's no way they're going to get people to spend that kind of money just casually. You know, you're going to have to really want a War for Cybertron Omega Supreme.
Yeah.
Well, I would argue that to spend $350 on any single toy, you're going to need to really want it, but that's just me.
Yeah, that's true. I'm not going to argue that.
Yeah. Yeah, I want it, but man, I don't want it that much.
I don't want it that much when for $100 or even, I don't know if it's less, but around $100, you're going to get essentially an official re-release of Omega Supreme in G1-ish colors for the Year of the Snake.
And so, it's really nice looking, too.
Yeah,
it is.
And it's got it's remolded.
It's remolded.
Parts, new head, and all that good stuff.
It's $100, and it's a shared exclusive. So yeah. It's going to be pretty easy to come by.
Hopefully it'll get marked down a little bit like G2 Bruticus did.
Oh, it's been marked down already?
Yeah, I got it for 48 right before Christmas.
Oh, I need a second one.
Yeah, I don't know if you need a second one.
Yes, I do. So I can open this one. Actually, go ahead.
Do I read this right? Did Big Bad Toy Store have loose sets? Oh, no, never mind. They had, oddly enough, they had like an actual set of loose G2 Combatagons on sale for a while.
Okay, I do have to say this. I probably shouldn't. So I'm going to Big Bad Toy Store to look at that, see if I can get it. And the first thing I saw was that they have Dice and Jinx from the G.I. Joe subscription service in stock.
Okay, and I should mention it was Amazon, by the way, that had the G2 Bruticus 48.
Well,
that makes more sense.
My mouse is hovering over the buy button, and I am trying to fight myself.
For what? The Jinx?
Dice.
Oh, Dice. Okay.
I want it.
Jinx.
Jinx isn't bad either, but I want Dice bad.
Did you also see where this is, I guess, somewhat random, too, but they're going to do a prop replica of the hoverboard from Back to the Future 2. Do people still...
That's a Maddie Collector deal, isn't it?
Yeah. Yes. And are people still that nostalgic for that?
There's gonna be Back to the Future Lego sets. That blows my mind. I don't get that.
I don't either. But apparently there've been a fair number of mini mates as well. So
It's $200.
But yeah, the hoverboard's actually already out, and they actually this is the part I love. They showed Bob Gale, one of the writers on Back to the Future.
The writer.
They showed him the prototype, and he thought it was great. He endorsed it. He thought it was wonderful. He got the finished model and actually made a point to rescind his endorsement because it was nowhere near the quality of the prototype they showed him.
Oh. I like it. Drama.
Mm-hmm. So it doesn't hover?
So, yeah. And I guess it's made out of, like, cardboard, I guess? It was just... So shocking to him.
He said the sound was wrong. The big thing is that the stickers on it were not the decals and details were not reflective the way they were on the prop in the movie. They also forgot the warning "Do not use on water" sticker on the box that it was supposed to have.
That's important.
Oh yeah, that is kind of important if you're going to charge $200 for the prop from a movie with a cult following. It's all those little things, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Once you're getting to that kind of money, you better have all your details right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Oh, Maddie Collector.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, last up in the third-party roundup this month, I'm not familiar with Fans Toys. This seems to be like one of the miscellaneous third-party producers? Or
real small time?
Are these the ones that do the steampunk toys?
You mean like the Hearts of Steel
stuff? Yeah.
I don't know. What are they doing?
So they're doing a masterpiece scale Shockwave.
Oh.
And the prototype looks good, but I'm not familiar with them, so I don't know what to expect, but I really need that 3D printer now. I feel more and more like I need that 3D printer. Looks nice.
It looks decent. I don't like the legs very much. I think they're a little bit too chunky, and I would like something a little bit more in the shape of the original Shockwave's legs, if that would be possible.
Yeah, but I can see that.
Yeah, the rest of it looks pretty good, but those legs just kind of bother me. Above the knees, looks really nice.
But G1 Shockwave kind of had chicken legs, though.
Yeah, a little bit. But again, I just like something... If not as thin, but as streamlined in shape as those legs were.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
I can agree. I can get behind that, because his legs are kind of generic, right? They're just kind of...
Oh, these are very generic,
Your standard chunko masterpiece-y legs. So. Mm-hmm. I do like the hose, though. I mean, all the, like, that's fun.
I would rather the hose come like from around the side instead of over the top. Maybe it will.
Maybe
so. I would hope so. That looks like, I mean, yeah, just, it may even be something you can do just with, if he's articulated right at the elbow, something you could almost do yourself.
Yeah, but, I mean, it looks good. It looks good. I would hope that Shockwave is a character that Takara would actually tackle. When you consider like the iconic G1 characters, I think Shockwave honestly comes up to me before Lambor does, before Sideswipe does.
Yes, but Lambor is very friendly to slight remolds and re-releases.
This is true. Mm-hmm. Very true.
Yeah. So, he's a cash cow.
But, I mean, but definitely Shockwave is... Definitely Soundwave, though, really could only be recolored, like, once to, like, another official character. And then after that... Yeah.
That's still one more, really, that you can get out of Shockwave in terms of actually being a character. I mean, you could make a gray one, but that's destined to, at best, be an e-hobby thing.
You could do a Shockwave.
Exactly. Yeah. But, yeah. But, yeah, there's
that.
Just, I mean, basically all the masterpieces fall into to one of two categories. You can either get three or four toys out of them, or they are super popular. And I'm not sure Shockwave is either.
Ah.
No, I'm not sure either, but that would be cool. It would be cool to see if they could engineer him somehow to have, and they would have, I'm sure they would, that would be their big challenge, is to engineer that additional, like, silencer-type add-on that he had in gun mode into his robot mode, so it's all, you know, together in one body. That would be the big magic trick with him. In a masterpiece form. And that would be cool. I bet you, I'd like to see them figure that out. I'm trying to think. You brought up a good question, though. Like, I wonder who's left on the list. I mean, is Ironhide or Ironhide Ratchet, are they big enough of a deal?
Yes.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, do you think they'd be pretty high? Prowl?
There's one obvious one, and I don't know that we'll get it. That's... Bumblebee, G1 Bumblebee.
Yeah.
We've gotten a masterpiece Bumblebee. Of course, it was the leader class version.
Uh-huh.
It was marketed as a masterpiece in Japan. I think it was. I know Optimus was and Starscream was. I'm pretty sure Bumblebee was.
I'm honestly surprised they haven't done the Coneheads yet, because that one's easy.
Yeah, I mean, you just that's a slight remold.
Yeah. It's just like, what, new wings, essentially. So, yeah, that's one they've left on the table. And then they've got kind of odd ones. I'll be honest with you. When you really look at the grand scheme of things, I still think Hot Rod and, to a lesser extent, Grimlock are kind of like these odd tangents that they took. When you look at the kind of like the blue chip characters that they've done historically.
I'm a huge fan of Rodimus and Hot Rod. Just let me leave that on the table. But Grimlock is a top tier. He is a top tier G1 character. He's right up there with Optimus and Megatron.
Mm. People, and he is a dinosaur.
He's a dinosaur. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I mean, I definitely think Ironhide and Ratchet would be good. I think that God. With the cone heads, I think Bumblebee, which you could get a cliff jumper out of. Yeah, you can actually get two or three things out of. Maybe, and Brawn.
You think Brawn?
With Brawn, you could get some, you could remold a Gears out of it. You could remold an Outback. There's like several different things you could remold. Kind of like they did with the G1 stuff. They basically had the same skeleton with a different, like, chassis.
Mm-hmm.
So just basically use the foundation for like that toy, and then you could use it for whatever. You could probably even like remold the heck out of a Bumblebee and make it into a Beachcomber.
Yeah.
It'd have to have a completely different shell. But
yeah, the framework is there, probably. Definitely, right?
Yeah, I think they could do that.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, and then obviously like Prowl Jazz. Those are tough ones. They're tough because they're they're obviously cars in the, I mean, they're in the same like family as Sideswipe and Sunstreaker, but they're just so, they're slightly, they're just different enough that it's hard to make them.
Like Mirage.
You're just starting over us again.
Yeah, so. Mirage and Hound.
Mirage and Hound, RCE.
Honestly, though, with Mirage and Hound, those, they could just as easily reissue the Binaltech version and call it a masterpiece.
Yeah, or they play off it. I'm sure they take all the notes they have on that and use it. Would they ever do an RC?
Yes. it's Takara. You know, in 10 more years, we'll probably have a masterpiece RC.
I'm kind of surprised they haven't done that yet. Or just tease the heck out of it. Because you get, what, Paradron Medic or however you say it?
Oh, yeah, you get two or three things out of that.
Yeah. Or even, how about this? Is this another Dinobot? Are any of the Dinobots worth the trouble?
I think if you use this, if you use the underlying skeleton to make another one, you could probably get Slag and then repurpose that for like a Sludge with like some major remolding. Heck, maybe even a Snarl. I mean, again, you'd have to use the underlying guts of it and then like have another shell on top of it. Yeah. I don't know that they would, because they really haven't gone in that direction before. Mm-hmm. Because it's not like an easy repaint or a slight remold. It would have to be a pretty substantial remold. Like, more along the lines of what they've done with between like the old version of Starscream and the new.
And you're getting to a point with some of those where you'd have to basically have some kind of universal armature at the core of it that you hang armor on. And I've had toy lines like that, and stability is very often an issue.
That's true.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I mean, I would love to see, God, we'll all three be in our 60s by the time it happens. But like the complete set of Masterpiece Dinobots, that would be pretty fantastic.
I think that's a lot more likely to be a third-party project than it is a Takara project, but...
Yeah.
Yeah, probably. I mean, I guess if anything, I wouldn't be shocked to see... Well, I'd be surprised, but a Swoop, maybe, but otherwise, nah. I guess not.
Sad trombone.
That's all right. We can't have it all. We can't have, like, five versions of the same... 10 characters like we've been getting the last 8 years forever.
Yeah. Right? So. I would just be happy having like Universe Classics Dinobots in deluxe scale.
I mean, at this point, chances are you're going to get that at some point. I mean, they keep going back to the well. It's gotten really... I'm not going to have the pity party again this week, but it is like... it is frustrating when you get... It's frustrating... When I look at my shelf of classics toys, and it's a bunch of characters that it was awesome 7 years ago when I got them again. It's gotten progressively less awesome as I've seen them over and over and over and over and over and over and over again.
Speaking of, I didn't mention this at the top of the show. I meant to. So last week, Rob, XV, Hey Mickey, who else was there? Paladin? Was Paladin there?
Ken.
They did What the Blank Hasbro. It was a RC special report on the current state of Transformers. It was really good. I really enjoyed it. It was sort of an alternative view of, you know, of things. And it was basically just like an all-out, you know, manifesto on what's wrong right now with Transformers. I really enjoyed it. And as Rob pointed out before the show started, he recorded that just... After he got his Fall of Cybertron Soundblaster, which is amazing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I got the best Transformer I have gotten all year, and then I had to go talk about why Transformers haven't really been that satisfying for me this year. The timing was just wonderful, but
but it was really good, really good. I really enjoyed it. And if you want another alternative view on Transformers, the new superhero time for this week is the best of the unaired stuff from 2012. So it's basically just lots of stuff that never made air and just a lot of fun commentary on Transformers. So in the show notes, we'll link to both of those. And if you haven't checked out last week's show, which was a ginormous 2012 year in review with Chris McFeely, go back and check that out. We'll link to that as well. Anything else, guys? Is that it?
I don't think so. Actually, just one real quick thing, since it is like third party day that we're recording. I did pick up the NOT Deluxe Insecticons.
Oh, do you like them?
From TF Source. That was my Christmas present. And so I will say I enjoy them immensely. I may at some point, if I ever find them cheap and loose at a BotCon, the regular Fans Project Insecticons, the three of them. Otherwise, for $50 a piece, nah, I don't think so. But as deluxe Insecticons, these molds are quite good. I may do a formal review at some point, but I would say you won't be disappointed if you get them. And I think they actually make better deluxe Insecticons than original Insecticons.
So were they just repainted or were they remolded as well?
They got new heads, which is good enough for us.
Yeah.
So obviously, so it's as good as a new character. And it's let's see, what is it? It's Ransack, Barrage, and Chop Shop. And so the one that they left out was Venom, which happens to be my favorite, but that's okay.
Yeah.
And they make a very nice trio. And since this is actually these are the second. Fans Project toys that I've gotten that are like fully formed Transformers, and the plastic quality is great. They feel right weight wise, and they don't feel like they're gonna fall apart. So I would definitely I would definitely recommend these and say they're a safe third party buy.
Awesome! Very cool. I want them pretty bad.
They look great.
Yeah.
They look great. They are great. They're store exclusive, so I would say there's probably a fair chance that they'll be marked down at some point, believe it or not, because even like the original Fans Project Insecticons would go on sale here and there while they were still abundant. So
I wasn't, just by the look of them, I was not a fan at all of the original Insecticons from Fans Project. But as soon as I saw those repainted as the deluxe Insecticons, I fell in love, so...
Yeah, it's another one of those like characters where it's just obscure enough, but also just nostalgic enough.
Yeah,
where it's a good idea, it's a cool idea.
That's awesome. So we will be back live next week, normal time 8:30 on Wednesday. So that will be what, this January 2nd, 2013. Wow.
Old. Hashtag old.
Hashtag old. That looks great. So, for the guys, I'm Brian Kilby. We will see you next week.
This has been Radio Free Cybertron. Visit us at tfradio.net for show notes and to subscribe to the podcast. Follow us on Twitter at TF Radio for news and updates. Watch our live stream at tfradio.net/live. Join our Facebook fan page at facebook.com/TF Radio. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, TF Radio Network. Have a question or comment? Leave it on our Facebook fan page or mail it to contact@tfradio.net. Copyright 2012 TF Radio Network.